Welcome. It's good to see everyone here this morning, this afternoon, lunchtime, something like that. I know some of you have been here for a little while. On behalf of the family, we're just glad that you're here. We're here to celebrate the life that God gave Ellen on earth and her eternal life forever in Jesus Christ. Let's open with a word of prayer. God, we thank you for this day that you have made. May we enter your gates with thanksgiving and your courts with praise. We're thankful that we can gather together, God. You've given us an earth and you've given us life. You've given us friends and family and your word. We pray especially for everyone that's here today that and their grief, we pray that you would comfort them. We pray that questions that people have, your Holy Spirit would answer them. We thank you for this day that we can gather and celebrate the life that you gave Ellen. We're excited that she has no more sorrow or pain or sickness, and that she's truly home in heaven with you and other people that she knows. We pray that you would be with us and comfort and guide us as we gather together in thanksgiving to you as a witness to your resurrection. In the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Will you stand as we sing How Great Thou Art?
Thank you.
And Lois, may you come forward to read our scripture?
This is Psalm 139, verse 1 through 6. O Lord, you have searched me. I guess I should use the mic. O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. You hem me in, behind and before. You have laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain.
To guide our prayer, I have a passage from the Old Testament, Isaiah 25, that I'd like to read a few bits of, and then I'd like to read from the New Testament in John chapter 14, where Jesus comforts his disciples. Isaiah 25, O Lord, you are my God, and I will exalt and praise your name. For in perfect faithfulness you have done wonderful things, things planned long ago. You've been a refuge for the poor. You've been a refuge for the needy and distress, a shelter from the storm, and a shade from the heat. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all the nations. He will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord himself will wipe away all tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. And in that day they will say, surely this is our God. We trusted in him and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation. And now Jesus, the night before his crucifixion to his disciples. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, I would have told you, and I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back to take you to be with me, that you may be where I am. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have done marvelous things in perfect faithfulness, things that you planned long ago. You've created the heavens and the earth by the power of your word. Your voice spoke and it came to be. You spoke into existence all that is. And the earth is charged with your grandeur. And we sometimes stop and marvel at the design and the beauty and the fine tuning of this universe you allow us to live in. You have also appointed each of us the number of days of our lives. You formed us in our mother's womb, you fashioned us, and you brought us into existence. We thank you for the more than 88 years ago, you ordained the life of Ellen. You created her, you nurtured her in her days, you sustained her, you stood by her, and you carried her through life and now death. What a beautiful gift you gave us with her life. So we thank you, Father, for revealing yourself to Ellen, that same voice that spoke creation into existence spoke to Ellen. Your voice, the voice of the Good Shepherd, and she trusted you and believed in you and followed you all her life. You became a refuge for her in times of need and distress and grief. You sheltered her amidst the storms of life. And she trusted you and you became her salvation and her joy. We thank you, Lord, for the particular roles that you called Ellen to serve in. She was a daughter, a sister, wife, mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, aunt, and a friend to so many. She carried out these roles among us with grace and warmth and a subtle, sly sense of humor. She loved you and your creation. And because of this love, she hiked and biked and traveled and gardened with great passion. We thank you also, Lord, for her example and how she faced death and dying these last days. She was full of dignity and faith, unafraid and unshakable. Her hope was in the risen Christ, and the promises of God were hers, and these were the source of her strength. And now that great banquet feast that Isaiah described and the room in her father's house that Jesus promised is now hers to enjoy forever. Gracious God, you tell us in the Bible that to be absent from the body is to be present with you. Thank you that Ellen is experiencing the fullness of joy the psalmist speaks about in Psalm 16. It is in your hands, God of grace and mercy, we commend Ellen, in the certain and sure hope that together with all the saints that have died in Christ, Ellen will rise with Christ in the last day, and we will be with her once again. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Let's continue to worship. Will you stand as we sing In the Garden? Please be seated. We're now going to have our time of sharing. A couple of things I like to share at memorial services is we hope two things happen, that you hear God's word and God's good promises so you can have faith And secondly, we love to share memories, because memories are a gift from God that we can take with us. And if we have sad days, we can take care, we can take these memories. And if we have happy days, we can also enjoy memories. So now is the time that the family is going to come and share.
Hello. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Glenn Payne, Alan's oldest son. I'll be speaking, and then my younger brother Dave will speak. And after that, if anyone else wishes to come up and say a few words of memory of Mom, we'd appreciate it. Also, if you could, if you have not done so, you could sign the guest book in the lobby. We'd appreciate it, so we have a record of whom all was here to attend. I remember that when Mom retired from the Stark County Human Services Department back in 1996, she told us all that her goal was to play more. Looking back, I have to say that Mom successfully accomplished that goal. Mom really enjoyed boating, bicycling, hiking, gardening, and golf. My mom and dad owned boats almost their entire married life. They bought their first boat, an 18-foot wooden Lyman, about a year after I was born, which tells you something. I still recall Mom working in the garage during the winter, sanding the wooden hull so they could apply new anti-fouling paint to the bottom. Over the years, they purchased three progressively larger boats until their final boat, dream boat, a 29-foot Sea Ray. Some of my fondest childhood memories are of Mom and Dad taking us water skiing on the inland lakes and on fishing trips to Lake Erie. In 1998, their grandson, Scott, got the privilege of accompanying them on a cruise with their boaters from the Power Squadron boat group from Sandusky up through the Detroit River and then up into Canada via Lake Huron. For many years, I flew back to Ohio from my home in California to meet Mom and ride our bicycles on the week-long Great Ohio Bicycle Adventure. We'd camp out and ride our bikes along with hundreds of other riders on varying routes of roughly 30 to 60 miles per day throughout rural Ohio. Many years, my younger sister Deb, or Aunt Lois, would join us on this adventure. In her later years, when Mom wasn't as comfortable with her stability on a two-wheel bike, she purchased an electric trike so that she could continue to ride with her friends on the local bicycle trails. In 2005, the year after Dad passed, Mom joined the Hilltop Hikers Hiking Club here in Canton and went on a week-long hiking trip to California, where they hiked Yosemite and Sequoia Kings Canyon National Parks. Since these parks are a several-hour drive from the San Francisco Bay Area, where Dave and I live, I met them in both of the parks and wound up joining the hiking club. Over the years, Mom and I got the pleasure of going on many week-long club hikes in various spectacular locales. We got to hike and visit in many beautiful areas that we wouldn't have gotten the opportunity to see otherwise. Some of my favorite hiking memories with Mom are of traveling to Hawaii, where we got to witness Joe and Jan O'Leary get married on the beach, going to beautiful Banff National Park in Western Canada, and then hiking the Red Rock Trails of Sedona, Arizona, an area that I fell in love with and where my wife, Mary, and I purchased a retirement home last year. In addition to the club hikes, Mom and I did several trips on our own. Mom had always wanted to visit Glacier National Park in Montana. Unfortunately, friends on the hike club said, "Hey, there are bears there. We're not gonna go there." So it was just her and I. We had a great week there. In another year, Mom accompanied me on one of my bucket list trips down to Havasupai Falls in Arizona. That's an amazing waterfall west of the Grand Canyon along the Colorado River. To get there, you have to hike down a 5-mile trail where you descend 2,500 feet in elevation. It's near one of the most remote villages in the United States. Mom was hoping that on the way back out, we could take the helicopter out. But we had no such luck, so we had to hike out in the summer heat, back up the half-mile elevation to the summit where we had parked. Like me, Mom lost her first spouse to cancer. It's always traumatic and lonely to lose a love partner. Mom was fortunate enough to meet Ray Thompson in church, where they dated and married in April 20, 2009. I found it ironic that in the circle of life, Mom wound up getting her maiden name, Thompson, back. Both Mom and Ray attended Ohio University, although they were several years apart. Interesting, both myself and my younger siblings, Dave and Deb, attended high school with several raised children. Mom and Ray were blessed to be able to spend almost 14 years married to each other. One of the things that I admire most about Mom is that, like her mother, Mom seldom complained about much. In her later years, Mom's health declined a little bit, but I never recall her complaining about it. In conclusion, Mom, thank you for the life you've blessed us with and that we've shared. We'll miss you dearly. Dave, you're on.
Hi, so as you've heard, I'm the middle child, Dave, and I'd just like to share a few stories and memories. So as Glenn talked about, we spent a lot of time boating as we were when we were young. And Mom told me one time that they had actually made a very conscious decision that, you know, what activity can we do as a good family activity? And they chose that boating was it. So we did lots of trips in the earlier years before they got the big cruiser boat. We would pack up the boat on a weekend and go around to one of the local lakes. So Mom, being the centerpiece of the family, did a lot of preparation for these trips, helping get all the towels together and the kids together. You know, do you have spare clothes and warm clothes? And get all the equipment into the boat that don't want to store there all the time. And she would prepare a meal. It was the classic meal of her fried chicken and baked beans, which I think was probably with brown sugar and bacon, and put them into two thermos containers. So I remember very clearly one evening, probably when Glenn and I might have been in high school, in one of the later years, where we were out at one of the local lakes, and after a busy, tiring day of water skiing and cruising and some fishing, pulled into a local, one of the side coves, quiet cove with nobody else around. The sun setting with the hills around, and we're eating the chicken and the baked beans, and a beaver came cruising along through the cove, slapping its tail on the water. I think that's the only beaver I've seen in the wilds in my entire life. I told that story to Deb the other last night. She's like, I don't remember the beaver. And Glenn. So that was wonderful. So Mom was always my sounding board when I was looking for advice when I was a kid. And she had kind of a classic line. I would come to her sometimes and say, well, there's this situation, and you know, I'm thinking of doing this. What do you think? It's like, well, Dave, you can if you want to, but then again, you don't have to. Well, yes, thanks, Mom. Which, you know, I took to realize that, of course, this is her way of telling me that you know, I trust you to make a good decision, and if not, then you'll learn from it and move on. So a particular one of those pieces of advice was actually a little different, that when I was in junior high, in my PE class, another student decided that I was going to be his victim. I was going to be the guy he was going to pick on. And so he started to do things like knock my books off the bench at the end of the class when we're getting ready to move on to the next class. I'm like tying my shoes, and he's And he was probably, you know, tapping me or whatever. I don't remember all those details. And this went on for a couple of weeks. And then finally, it had built up enough that finally one night, I asked Mom, told her the situation, described what's going on, and asked, so what do you think? The advice was different that time, and it kind of surprised me, and maybe I'm telling this in the church, but her advice was, hit him back. Whoa. So the very next day, this guy decides to take it to the next level, and he starts harassing me as we're walking down the hallways in class change. And when we reached the main intersection of the main hallway, which is about 30 feet from the principal's office, I think it was maybe then that he decided to knock my books out of my hand with all the people around, and okay, it's time to hit him back. And I don't think I connected, but clearly he'd been planning this because the first thing he did was knock my glasses off, which, as a good child geek, sent me to the floor wondering, my glasses, because there's a lot of people walking by. Now, mind you, this is also about 30 feet from the principal's office, and so the teachers were on us like that, into the principal's office, and the principal had a more formal way of paddling people than perhaps the less formal, but still. So Mom had prepared me for that event as well. So I'm sitting there stoically, and the other student is crying away over in the corner. And I realize, that student must have a much tougher life than I have, and I hope he's done well. But I will say that he never harassed me again after that day. So thank you, Mom, for that more specific piece of advice in that case. So at a more personal level, as you all know, Mom had a very active life with, I'll probably forget some of them, the gardening, the golf, the hiking, biking, cross-country skiing, canoeing. So I'm happy to have inherited her physique and some of her values of a thrifty nature and an adventurous spirit, which is among the things that got me into biking and running and now into ultramarathons as I go explore trails in all these just amazingly beautiful places. When it came time for college, Mom's advice, request, was that, well, you can go anywhere you want to college except California. That's too far. Which in the 70s, after the 60s, I took to mean, except California. That's too weird. So I went off to school in Boston and stayed out there for a few more years, and then the computer industry drew me to California anyway. And I've been out there in Silicon Valley for the last 35 years. Glenn followed shortly afterwards. So I think she probably missed a bit the fact that we weren't there. But my lovely wife, Vicki, and I have tried to make it up to her some with taking her on some of the adventures that we went on, of trips to New York and Los Angeles and Chicago, and also, Mom, would you like to go to Spain? Sure. Okay, how about Taiwan and Thailand? Sounds great, let's do it. So she was always game for an adventure, which was wonderful. So in closing, I'd like to thank all of you who have been a part of her life, sharing many of these types of adventures. And I'd especially like to thank Ray Thompson, and Nan, and Rick, and Trish, and Carrie, and the entire family. For being such a huge part of her life in the past 14, 15 years. So, thank you. Anyone else?
Well, I think we need a little Thompson representation up here. So I just needed to take the chance to say how much we really appreciated Ellen in our life. When my dad lost my mom, he was sad and lonely, and this woman in church kind of came over and sat by him. And then about 14 years ago, we were all here in this church celebrating their marriage, and they had a good 14 years together. And that is the one thing that Ellen said to him the day before she died, Ray, we had a good 14 years. And they did. They hiked, and they went out to dinner, and they enjoyed dinner with friends. I've talked to so many of the hiking people today, and just the dinners and the celebrations you had, it really enriched their lives. And so Ellen just really brought that, and I appreciated how well she loved my dad. But the other thing I appreciate about Ellen is we have this kind of loud and crazy family and with 13 grandchildren, and she was always such a good sport. She sat at soccer games, some very cold and rainy soccer games, and hockey games, and lacrosse games, and cheerleading competitions, and volleyball games, and orchestra concerts, band concerts. I mean, anything that was going on in our family, she was willing to be there and encourage us. And we just appreciated that so much about her. And then the other thing that our family talks about is her resilience and her strength. And she never let anything get her down. And yet, and the boys talked about how she was so strong and just had a zest for life. And we saw that over and over again. And as a matter of fact, we termed her the Energizer Bunny because she would take a licking and keep on ticking. Nothing could keep her down. And not neck surgery, not knee surgery. And I told the kids a story. When she had knee surgery, she was sitting there, it was about January, and she was in her wheelchair, and her knee was swollen, and her leg was black and blue. And she said to me, Nan, she goes, the doctor says I'll be hiking by June. And I was like, I called my sisters. I said, Ellen thinks she's going to be hiking by June. There's no way she's going to be hiking by June. And she definitely proved me wrong because she was not only hiking by June, she was actually hiking by April. So that's Ellen. And you who hike with her know that that's her. My brother spoke to this. I was so encouraged by her bravery at the end. The last 2 weeks were very tough on her, and she knew that, you know, the end was near and she was getting weaker. And I saw her rely on her faith and her love for Jesus, and she knew that she was going to heaven. And that was so encouraging to me. So I just want to say to the Payne family, thank you for sharing your mom with us, and we so, so appreciated her. Thank you.
Other memories that someone would like to share? Great.
Hello, everyone. I'm Scott Payne. I'm Ellen's grandson, Dave's son. Wasn't planning to speak, but all the stories of her being so active reminded me of one. So this is my dad, and this is my stepmom, Vicky, over here. I'm getting recorded, and I would prefer not to be, but... So my parents split up when I was 5, 1992. So I had the somewhat unique experience of getting to... share the experience with a parent of helping them find their life partner, and watched my dad go through many, many stages of dating lots of folks in you know, his 30s. And he had a running list of criteria, most of which were informed by bad experiences that would be like, oh, that was terrible about a specific person. We're adding something to the list. And it'd be things like, no vegetarians, because I want someone I can go out to eat with. And the list was evolving, and I don't always remember it, but he would kind of like recite it as we were on the way to school, you know, kind of the ongoing list. One of the very early inclusions that he put in his own words was, must be more active than my mother. And we don't mean my mother, we mean his mother. And, you know, at the time she was 60 years old or so. And then she retired and the bar moved. Because there was a certain level of activity, and then she started doing bike trips across Ohio, and then she started doing 100-mile bike trips, and then she started doing lots of other activities. And at some point, we were kind of talking through this, and we're like, this is not an achievable bar anymore. So that got actually the one item that ever got struck from the list. And Vicky is wonderful and brings many, many wonderful qualities and a very adventurous person, but we did have to eventually compromise on the more active than Grandma. So just wanted to share that.
Well, I, too, wasn't going to come up here because I figured I was going to be the blubbering person. One of my mom's greatest joys, as I said, was watching her family grow. I had the pleasure of being the family in Ohio, so I got to go on the hike trips and the bike trips locally. She got to spend lots of time with her children and her grandchildren and watching them grow, taking them up to Lake Erie for a week. Yes, and seeing the great-great-grandson. And we've been very blessed. And you guys have all shared in those memories. And she was, it's a life well lived, as I told many of you. She just lived her life to the fullest, to the very last minute that she could. And I'm so blessed that I got to spend so much time with her. A bunch of you in the hike club will know, you know, cards. I'll never play a game of Skip-Bo again without thinking of my mother. It was something we did every weekend I came up. Ray Thompson, you got sick of watching us play cards for hours and hours and hours on end. We would play all the time. You know, planting flowers, digging up flowers. My husband planting trees, moving trees. Moving them a little bit this way, a little bit that way. You know, Mom was particular. We all know it. And we get a good laugh out of it. And so did she. Last week in the hospital, we called her Oak Tree a few times because that was the one that my husband had to move around about four times before she finally decided on what was probably the original hole, that that's where she wanted that tree. So I didn't really have anything great to share. Like I say, her greatest love was she wanted her family to be happy and healthy and to bring lots of joy to the world, and they're doing their best. And thank you all for sharing our lives with us. And that's all I have. And thank you.
Others from anyone from the bike? We've got a lot of clubs here. So we've got the Bicycle Club, Folks on Spokes, Hilltop Hikers. Anybody from those relationships want to share a word? Yes, come on up.
Oh, you just saying you were a part of that. Okay.
Oh, no, you raised your hand. Come on up. Just like in school.
Well, that was wonderful. It helps me to know Ellen better. And when I was visiting Ellen in the last couple of days, I got to know a lot more about her also. And I like what's said in the obituary. And she talked a little bit, her and Ray talked a little bit more about how active of a life they led. And so whenever I come to a point which we would call a eulogy, I always try and think about, well, what would I remember about the person? What am I going to remember about this person? Maybe a lot, depending on how well we know them, but how will I remember them and relate a scripture to them? And there is a scripture that, is it going to be on the screen, Rob, that I would like to read. And this, after getting to know some of this, it reminded me of a scripture that Paul wrote to Christians in a city called Corinth. And in the Bible, some of the Bibles today have little headings in certain areas, and it was under running the race. So I thought that would be a good illustration to think about Ellen's life and a scripture to tie that to it. It says, do you not know that in a race all of the runners run or hike or bike, right? But only one gets the prize, question mark? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes on in strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Next slide. I want to put one more verse on it. It says, and everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. When we think about that, and we think about, if you'll enter in this with me, if we think about life, I'd like us for a moment to think about life as a race, a walk, a hike, a bike, whatever activity that you like. And typically when we do these things, we think we're going to go somewhere, right? We hope to enjoy the ride or the bike or the hike. But typically we're going to go, well, we want to reach this particular point, and maybe when we get there we'll turn around. But this is a goal, is to reach this particular point in this activity. So Paul, which was an apostle in the Bible, and that meant that he was a herald. He wanted to proclaim God's good news. And so when he was writing to these Christians, he was like, I want you to think about your life as a runner. And some run a race to get crowns. And one crown is a perishable crown, meaning, you know, a crown that eventually is going to wear out or rust out or fade away or get thrown in the closet. And after a while, no one's going to remember it. And some people, when they run their race of life, they run it for an imperishable crown, a crown that will last forever, meaning they're going to get some type of a prize, and this prize is going to be of such great value that Paul used the words imperishable. I recently heard a statement, it was on a talk show, and the person that was speaking said, I want to ask you a question. They said, How much of your life would you give up if you received $1 million? How many days would you take off of your life if someone today would grant you that much money? And the person that was going to answer the question went, you know, maybe like kind of you did when you, if that was a question that was asked to you. And the person said, well, I've never really thought about that before. And he says, well, let's make it a little bit more interesting. How much of your life would you give up if someone was going to offer you $10 million. And eventually the person said, none. I'm not going to give up part of my life, right, this gift from God on earth, for money. And he said, wow, you know, I've never thought about how precious my life is, that I really wouldn't give up any of my life for $10 million. And so that was what Paul was trying to encourage these Corinthians to think about. It was like, you know, life is a gift, and we love the trees and the mountains and the lakes and the coves and the sunshine. I was in Toledo this weekend, and it was even snowing. I can't say that I wasn't enjoying the snow, but my wife sure was. And so I thought, life is a gift, and it's so wonderful, and each day is so precious. I think Paul was wanting them to say, every day is precious, so don't waste any days. And don't spend your days grumbling and unthankful and irritable, because wow, it's a gift, and we'll never get that particular day back. And so it kind of goes into choices. I have a heading here on my notes, life choices. Because one thing that God has given each of us is free will, right? None of us wanted to be created a robot. And so God says, I'm going to give you, as my created being, a life on earth. I'm not going to have you be a robot, and you have choices. You have choices of this day and that day, and I've given each of you different gifts, right? I think about careers, and so I Googled. I said, how many different gifts, like doctor, nurse, engineer, pastor, teacher, right? And Google told me, I don't know if it's right, but, you know, 12,000 different gifts. Maybe there's more. And so we get to choose how we use the gifts that God has given us. And so the question is, how am I using my gift? How are you using your gift? How did Ellen use her gift? And at the end of life, what type of crown did she receive? Perishable crown or an imperishable crown? Because, you know, hikers and bikers and swimmers and boaters, I wish I'd have known her a lot younger, because I like all those things, especially that 29-foot sea ray. Whoa, I like that. Obviously, it said in the obituary that she graduated from OU, and she got a degree in secretarial studies. So that's awesome, right? She had the gifts of organization and planning and helps. And then she also had other gifts, which you guys have spoke about wonderfully, being a boater and a hiker and a biker. Oh, and golf. And I love golf. I really would have gotten along with her well, which I did, but we didn't do any golfing. So at the end of our lives, when we think about Ellen, you know, we think about what gift did she give? Paul's trying to say, at the end of your life, what kind of crown or gift are you? I mean, when you hike up to this lake and get on this mountain and see this, that's a gift. But, you know, and those are enjoyable because life is a gift from God. But at the end of this, what type of, how's it all going to end? And so Paul throws up two things for him to remember. He says, there's an imperishable gift, and there's a perishable gift. And so Paul's life was spent going around all over Asia and Asia Minor, Turkey, you know, today, that area. And what he wanted to do is let everyone know that this was an option, right? That all of life is good, but at the end there was something that they were going to obtain or not obtain. So he decided to spend his whole life doing that. And God says, I'm going to give you life on earth. And whether you live 10 years or 99 years, at the end of this, you're going to have had to make some choice out of your free will, and that is, who's going to be your God? Is God the one that created heaven and earth? Are you going to let me be your God, or are you going to live all of your life and end your life on earth with you being your own God? And you say, well, why is that so important? Because if you believe the Bible says that we all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. Meaning, when I do something to hurt you, or you do something to hurt me, then we've also hurt God, because who created all of us? And that is none other than God, right? So if you hurt my child, I'm going to be upset about it, right? If someone hurts that little boy right there, someone in those two pews, which I've seen you guys passing this young man around, if I hurt that child, I'm going to have to pay the penalty, aren't I? Yes, say amen. I'm going to get him, amen, say amen. And so God says, if you're going to hurt other people, you're going to need to be forgiven. That's a debt you owe. The Bible, some people say in the Lord's Prayer, forgive us our trespasses. Have you heard that? Some people say, forgive us our debts. Well, what that means is, God said, if you choose to do that and hurt other people, you're going to owe me a debt, and it has to be paid. So Jesus came down. God came down in the form of a man, died on the cross. That's why we have the cross here, and said, I'll pay your debt for you. I'll die in your place. I'll pay your sin debt. And so God has done that in Christ, and we each get a choice of whether we want to choose that or not. We can say, well, I don't choose to have my debt paid by you. I'll pay my own debt. And that means you'll be separated from God forever, because humans can't pay their own debt. We're doing a study here in the church, and it's called Giving Up Something for Lent. Some of you and your Christian tradition, or some of you in your churches might observe what we call Lent here. And Lent is a 40-day period leading up to Easter, where we think about our lives and we think about, what am I doing, what am I not doing? And it is symbolism of when God was on earth and he went out into the desert for 40 days. And he prayed and he fasted for 40 days. And then he defeated being tempted by fame, fortune, and power. So we're doing this study, and we were talking about giving up condemning people and hurting people, right? Because when we speak bad about people and we hurt them, it's hard to know the impact of harsh words on other people, right? And so we read this, and it's very short. It said, there was a junior high honor student. This gal was a member of the band and secretary of her class, but she lost the battle in life because she couldn't fight the rumors and the rejection any longer. See, what had happened is a neighbor had seen her coming home at night and then started rumors. It says this was the rumor that a neighbor started about this young girl. That she had come home at daylight in a drunken stupor, her clothes disheveled, delivered to the door by an older man in a fancy car. But here was the truth. This young lady had sat up all night at the hospital with her gravely ill grandmother, and had been brought home early the next morning by her uncle. And because it was a small town, and the rumors kept going on and on, she lost the battle. And I think that if we think about some of the words that I've said to people, and words we've said to other people, we would agree that we've hurt other people, and that needs to be paid for. And so that's why Paul said, do you not know that those who run in a race all run? So let's think about that for a minute as life. But one receives the prize,
and everyone who competes for the prize is temperate. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown or an imperishable crown. So the good news is that life on earth isn't the end, right? How would you like to say, hikers or bikers, that I'm going to get to hike or bike forever? Right, I'm going to get to go on another trip. I'm going to see another mountain. I'm going to see another cave. I'm going to have another beautiful waterfall. Well, the Bible says that if we accept Christ as our Lord and Savior, which Ellen did, that when her mortal body wore out, she got an imperishable crown, and that crown was the gift of eternal life because all of her sins had been paid in full. So when I think about Ellen and I think about all these activities, I'm going to think about the end of her life's race was to get an imperishable crown. Wow. How about that? Isn't that awesome that Ellen is probably, while we're sitting here hiking and biking, who knows what she's doing, and she doesn't have any pain. And she doesn't have any sickness. Ellen ran life's race well. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you give us free will. We thank you that you've given us life on earth to make choices. We thank you for Ellen's choice. We thank you that she took her crown and gave it to you because you died for her. Lord, we can't wait to see her again someday. So I pray that you would tell her hello from us today as she's enjoying herself. We thank you for all the friends and family that have come all the way from California and all over the place to be here, to support the family, to give each other hugs, and to enjoy this gift that you've given each of us called life. I pray that you would bless them as they fly back home or ride back home in a car or spend time having a dessert together today. We thank you that you're a good, good God, and we thank you for your faithfulness. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let's sing about God's faithfulness as we close. Will you stand?
Thank you.
God, we pray your blessings upon every person here today. May they know of your great faithfulness, that your promise says, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. Thank you for life on earth, and thank you for Ellen and this family. In the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. May you be seated, please, and we're going to let the family come out first. And then if you'll go straight down the hall to the right. Another thing that's great about this family is they said, we want all desserts. I'm up for adoption, guys. Wow.